That's Gordon Haskell. They're a very lovely single out in time for, I guess, for the Christmas period now. It's nice for all the weddings that we just so hopefully dedicated that to before that came out. We have with us, well, let me just, before I introduce you to our final guest on the show today, let me just read a few names out to you. Muhammad Ali.
Yeah.
Rocky Marciano.
Yeah.
Sugar Ray Robinson.
Yeah.
Floyd Patterson.
Yeah.
Some of the greatest boxers who ever lived. All of them stood in the square ring. The canvas thingamajig. With this man, Sir Henry Cooper, OBE. Henry, thank you so much for coming in.
Well, John, it's a great pleasure. Thank you.
Well, don't say that yet.
I won't get at him
first. It's great. Thank you so much for coming. How are you doing? How's your health? How are you these days?
Pretty good. I'm limping at the moment. You might notice I came in limping in with a stick, but I've just had a new knee replacement put in about a month ago. Wow. So, you know, it's going to take 3 months to be, you know, normal, I suppose, again.
But, what's that, what happened to the old knee? What was wrong with it?
I suppose I knackered it with all the training I did in heavy boots. See, what people don't realise is that boxers, we run. We have to run every day of our life.
You need that stamina, don't you?
Yeah, you have to build your stamina. So I used to run 7 miles every day in heavy commando boots, but not knowing that on made-up roads, knowing that you're knackering your knee. So I had, on my right-hand knee, I had my cartilage out about 35 years ago, and they used to do a fair bit of damage going in them days.
I bet they used to go in using just a hacksaw, didn't
well,
they?
Well, that's it, wallop crash back.
A hacksaw and a welding mask, they used to wear, went back. Now, that was advanced surgery. I mean, that was if you went private.
That was good.
Because you trained in the boots because you were in the army when you first boxed.
I was boxing before, but naturally I went in the army in 52.
Was that national service?
National service.
See, that's what we need today.
52, 54, and we were in the boxing battalion. We were there for boxing, you know, which was great. You know, we had a couple of wars going on.
When you say you were in the boxing battalion, this wasn't a battalion they just used to send the boxers in during war. I think that'll sort the hunt out. Let's send the boxers in. Keep your guard up, lads.
Keep your guard up, yeah.
I've been doing a bit of boxing training myself.
But it's good, the old
training. Bloody hell, it's hard work, isn't it?
Oh, it's hard, yeah.
It's exhausting.
You punch your bag for 3 minutes, you know you've done it.
I have more respect for boxers than I ever had before, having, you know, I mean, I don't actually box, obviously, but just trying to do it for like 3 minutes, and afterwards you're glowing, your heart rate's up.
Oh, yeah, Christ, your blood pressure, or God knows what else.
And bear in mind, you know, you're trying to keep away from the other fella and you're trying to land a few. That really is quite something.
Yeah, well, it's something we get used to, and let's say fighters or boxers, you know, you train certain muscles, toughen your body up, you know, you do neck exercises and body exercise, so, you know, a lot of people say, how do you take the punches? Well, I mean, if someone came, I explain it that, you know, when most people have played football, and if you've been running for a ball and someone kicks your ankle, that it hurts because you've got the adrenaline and you go, and it's just the same as boxing. People say, does it hurt? Well, I said, if it didn't hurt boxers shouldn't be in the ring.
That's the same as me during talk shows sometimes. I just keep my head down and keep going through the pain. You keep going through the pain and afterwards you count the cost. Is that correct, sir? That's correct. But you boxed, you know, for our country for many, many years. Fantastically, very successfully. You were heavyweight champion. Well, on and off, actually, weren't you? Because you lost it. And
well,
then
I was British heavyweight champion for like 10.5 years. You know, I won. I was the longest reigning British heavyweight champion of all time. Yeah. I every now and again, when it suited me or suited Jim Wicks, we handed the European Championship back to him because the European wanted to manage it. Well, I was paying Jim Wicks 25% to manage me, so when it didn't suit us, we handed it back. But then we won it back on several occasions, one or two occasions.
Yeah. The belts. How many belts did you win over the years, though? What did you?
Three Lonsdale belts. So you had to win the title and defend it successfully twice. You know? So you fought for it three times.
And then it's yours.
And then you made it your own problem. And I went on and won three of them,
Looking back, what were the fights that were the most satisfying for you in terms of, you know, boxing as a sport, almost as an art form? What were the ones that you look back and say, that was me at my very best?
Well, I mean, I fought a lot of good American fighters. You know, I mean, I fought three world champs. All right, I admit I lost them on cuts sometimes, you know, but Ingemar Johansson, Floyd Patterson and Ali.
These were fairly early 60s.
They were all early. Yeah, I was very young in them days. But I had some good fights. I beat a guy called Zorro Foley, who was joint number one contender for the world title. There was him and Eddie Machin. They were joint number one contender. Great box fighter. And I beat him.
Now, Henry, what's happened to boxing, though? Because just those names you mentioned there. You mentioned a Swede. You mentioned Zorro Foley. You mentioned these. They were European boxers of great stature and strength. And there seemed to me, nowadays, it seems that boxing is dominated by Americans. Black boxers seem to dominate the sport. As well, the white boxers aren't there anymore.
No.
What's happened to the game in that respect? Why is it that it seems to have been so
much
more
limited? It's all a matter, basically, of economics. You know, I mean, see, why are you get? You see, if you take America. is a classic example. See, if you're talking about in the 20s and 30s, the three immigrant nations to America were the Jews from Russia, Poland, they all went to America. You had the Irish from Ireland going there. You had the Italians.
Yeah.
So, hell of a lot of... they all lived in ghettos of New York, Chicago. So they were fighting. Yeah. They were fighting to make their way out. So you had, in them days, you had a lot of Italian, a lot of the Irish, and a lot of Jewish fighters. Now, if you look at the scene in America, they have all gotten on, they've all moved out, all Jewish mums want their sons to be lawyers and things like that. But now, Italians own shops and restaurants. If you look at the biggest influx to America now are Puerto Ricans and Mexicans. Now, if you go in the gyms now, you've got dozens of Puerto Ricans and Mexicans.
Essentially, what we're saying is you can almost directly link boxing and boxing success with those people who are at the lower rung of the scale.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That's very interesting.
Yeah, you don't get good fighters coming from...
apparently Prince Edward is quite handy as well.
But, I mean, when you've had a silver spoon in your mouth, when the going gets tough...
You can't use it with gloves.
You're not allowed to stick a spoon in someone's
That's
right.
Very interesting. You know, I hadn't realised it was that clear a kind of link, but, of course, that does make sense.
Yeah. That's why, if you look at in England now, I mean, most of the fighters now are black because, you know, you've got black or Asian because now, you know, they're all fighting to get out of particular areas they're living in. They will live in perhaps some of the worst areas in the country. So professional boxing is still, it's still a way of earning a living and getting out and bettering yourself,
So presumably though, we'll see a change, a shift in that yet again, one would imagine, in the future. You know, now at the moment it seems that people are flooding in from Eastern Europe. We'll see a shift again. That's
again,
Looking back at pictures of you in the book, and the book, which is called just called Henry Cooper, it's the authorised biography. It's the first authorised biography, I believe.
Yeah, that is. Yeah, I did my autobiography about 30-odd years ago, but it was time to do this, I think, because people were coming up to me and saying, where can we get a book on your career?
Yeah.
Well, they couldn't because it was out of print, but this one, I think...
Once every 30 years, we can hardly accuse you of flooding the market. It's not like you're exploiting your position here. It's like, you know, Joey Halliwell's had two out, and she's only won one belt.
20, yeah.
She's quite handy, though. Lean, I think she's middleweight.
She's a good puncher, is she?
You were heavyweight, of course.
Yeah.
But look at the pictures of you. Yeah, you're a light heavyweight because you lean, mean fighting machine. You're not a kind of... Well, nowadays, the guys you see, they seem more pumped up.
Oh, yeah, but they're all... See, they all bulk up more now. See, heavyweights now are much bigger. If I was boxing today, there's when I was boxing, there were six weights, flyweight to heavyweight. Now there's 17 different weights.
Wow.
See, there's 17 different weights, and you've got like say middleweight, then you've got super middleweight, you've got light heavyweight, which is 12 stone 7, then you've got cruiserweight, which is 13 stone 8, which I was when I was boxing, and then you've got anything over 13 stone 8, you're a heavyweight. So that's it. But they're big now. They're all 6'5", 17.
The super heavyweights.
They do much more weight training.
Because you look in the pictures once again, you can see all the musculature there. You can see your body. You see definition. But they're not kind of pumped up and big in the way that nowadays we see people where they've worked to make the muscles.
Well, if you see Big Frank, Big Frank had like cannonballs for muscles.
He
couldn't stretch his arms. His arms were all restricted because he had done so much, I think, weight training in his career, and it wasn't good for him.
So further to that then, would I be right in thinking that boxing, the level of skill involved in the game, actually it was probably more interesting to watch boxers such as yourself, Floyd Patterson, these guys, because there was much more technique involved.
Yeah.
More of a sport.
As you've been saying, you've been calling us boxers. Now they don't call them boxers, they call them fighters.
Yeah,
and that's what they are. If you see trainers in corners now, they're only doing one thing. They're only saying to their fighters, go forward, go forward. Come forward, come forward. They think there's only one way of fighting, that's going forward. Seeing a lot of the kids now, they don't learn, like, slipping techniques and this, that and the other. They do a lot of this pad work. And I've seen, and I think, to be honest, it all looks good, but I think the pads sometimes are the worst thing out because kids sling punches. They're
so
not
pad
looking.
Work is teaching them where to hook and where to deliver a punch.
But pads don't hit your back. Pads don't hit your back.
No,
if you had someone in front of you with a glove on, he could hit you with it.
That's what I say. When I'm training at the moment, I always say, hit me. Go on, I'm not scared, hit me.
You're brave.
They can't get me. I'm too fast. we're with Sir Henry Cooper, OBE. Couldn't be happier. He is the greatest boxer this country's ever produced. There's no doubt about that. He's got his book out right now, just in time for Christmas, I noticed, which is
I can't
think of a better gift for many people. Henry Cooper is the title of the book. It's as simple as that, and it's from BBC Books, so you know it's quality.
Yep.
There's no doubt about it.
Robert Edwards has done a good job, I think. I've read it, and I like what I've read.
Yeah, it's a biography written by Robert Edwards with Henry's full cooperation. Henry, Earlier on, I made a joke that you were going to sing on the show, but someone emailed me and said you did have an album out once in which you one of the tracks on it was called Henry Cooper's Knockout Party.
Yeah.
Thanks to Mick Page from Welling Garden City for emailing me this fact. And one of the tracks, of course, was I'm Henry VIII.
I'm Henry VIII, and all that. Knock me down with a feather and all that, yeah.
So really, for you as a youngster, the choice was pop or boxing?
It was definitely both. No.
We're going to play a bit more music. We're talking more to Henry Cooper after this. We're here with Sir Henry Cooper, OBE. Henry, put a word in for me, will you? I haven't had any awards yet. What's wrong?
I'll have to talk to someone.
They just haven't got to the R's yet, is that it? So Henry Cooper, he's got his book out, just called Henry Cooper. It's written by Robert Edwards with Henry. It's out for Christmas. Fantastic pictures in. And you know what I love about it is it spans this incredibly, all the most interesting periods, I think, of the last 100 years.
Before. Yeah.
When were you born? Was it in the 30s?
1934.
So during the, you were a youngster when the Second World War broke out.
We lived in London all through the war years, yeah.
You evacuated? Did you leave?
We were evacuated for about 6 months, but hated it, so they mum brought us back into London. But
so this was you and your twin brother, George?
Twin brother and my elder brother. I had an elder brother as
Can
well.
You imagine being some nice family out in the countryside, and so they said, we've got a couple of little Londoners for you, and it's George and Henry Cooper turn up?
Yeah.
I bet you were towers, weren't you?
Well, we wasn't angels, that's for sure.
How many policemen did you kill back then? Before he was nine, he killed 27 policemen with his bats.
Like I only knocked him out in the ring because I boxed a few coppers. Yeah.
Of course you did, yeah. There must have been, I would have thought, at the time, it felt like the sport was the only way out for you. Looking back now, when you see what boxers earn today and how the sport is today, it must seem like a totally different thing. Is it?
Well, it is a different... I mean, the you can't compare the years I was boxing with them now because, even when I fought Ali, say that was worth, like, for the world title fight in 66, 50,000 quid.
Yeah.
That equates to about, 600,000 quid now.
Wow.
But they're getting £15 million now.
Unbelievable.
I mean, if you get someone like Lennox Lewis got £15 million for the last fight.
Do you know
which
what?
Which is unbelievable.
Henry, I think you could still take Lennox.
Oh, I don't know.
You
no,
could
no.
take
Tyson. Not with a gammy leg.
Leg. We put you in a bath chair. I'll wheel you out. You could beat them.
As long as you can move quick.
Spin around. I'll keep you out of the way. Don't worry. I've been training. Do you still watch the sport? Do you still enjoy
it? Yeah, well, of course. I mean, if you've done something like I did for 27 years of my life, yeah, of course you're still interested in it. And I get a little bit disillusioned because there's so much hype in the game now. See, and which gets me down a little bit because I was brought up in the era where you got in the ring at 9:30 and I most of my last 10 and a half years were all championship fights, so they were always in the ring at 9:30.
And they went the distance, didn't they?
Well, a lot of them went the distance, but the big thing was that you got in there. See, they I've seen them bring fighters in the ring now in sedan chairs with newborn slaves. I've seen them bring on magic carpets. They bring them in cranes, Harley Davidson motorbikes.
They teleport in sometimes.
They stand in a searchlight doing nothing.
And you've got all the music. You've got simply the best, and you're getting Nassim flip flops in like he does.
Fireworks displays. You have laser beams.
Nassim rode in on the back of a firework, I believe, once. He was sent in by a child. Fired him in from a catapult.
There's too much hype in the game now, which I think with proper boxing fans, they don't want to see that. It's all right if you're appealing to someone who's just looking at it as an interest sort of thing, but if you look at the boxing aficionados, they don't want that. They just want to see the guy get in the ring and start the fight.
But you know why, Henry?
It takes them 40 minutes to get in the ring now.
But they want the big audience, they want the big money, and that's how you get it, of course.
Yeah, that's it, yeah.
Let's talk about the Ali fight a little bit. I know this is probably the thing that always comes up, but I'm just interested from the perspective that this was in 66, and it's also that was the year that England won the World Cup.
That was the second one, the World Title fight.
But what a remarkable year that must have been in the country. You must have felt like it was a special time to be British.
Yeah. I mean, it was great to be British because we'd already won the World Cup. The World Cup, and then my fight, I think, came after the World Cup, and that was for the world title. You know, it went six rounds. Unfortunately, I got that cut again, which was my bugbear. You know,
you used to cut fairly easily, didn't you?
Well, I mean, it wasn't easy. I mean,
don't take me wrong, Henry. It's not a criticism. You see how quick he lived. I'm just saying, because you had such a handsome, well-defined face it was a target for the jealous boxer to go for.
That's it. Yeah, no, but as I say, he slung a punch, and I slung a left hook, you see it coming, and he came to knock it away, and he chopped down with the heel of the glove which went, you know, straight across the eyebrow and just slit it open. It was just like a mouth. It was pumping blood, and then the referee had to stop it.
And there's a photograph of you in there, and it looks
a bit gory, doesn't it? But
it looks like you just come out of like a long session in the mines. You know, you look like a coal miner. So much blood on the face there.
Yeah, and it looks when I'd shave. I used to look like when I shaved.
You know what's so nice about talking to Henry is, you know, you've got all your marbles.
Well, that's the great thing. Yeah, I mean, I had them. I had 27 years. I had 11 years as an amateur and 17 years as a pro. And, you know, and they all knock boxing. But as I say, I mean, if you look after yourself, you train properly, you don't cheat on your trainers and your managers, you know, very few little will happen to you, you know what I mean?
I guess the key as well is knowing when to call it a day.
Well, that's it. That's what the big thing is, yeah. Cool. See, I had 55 fights as a pro over a 17-year period, all right? I wasn't overboxed. When I was injured, I had good rest in between so that the injuries healed properly. And that's the secret. You know, you've got... All fighters have got so many fights in them. And if you have them all, too many too early, you know, you burn yourself out a bit. So you've got to... You've got to pace yourself, yeah.
This is what I've always said.
Yeah, you've got to be a good pacer.
Let's have another track, and we'll chat to Henry some more after this before we finish up the show. What are you going to play, Andy?
I play a bit of Zager and Evans because it's short, so we've got enough time to say goodbye.
Shall we end on that, then?
Why don't we just
chat till the end of the show, and we're chopping and changing, and then, you know...
You've got about another minute and a half.
Oh, well, that's OK, then.
Yeah.
What weight do you prefer watching? As a fan of boxing, as a kind of a sport and a pursuit, which can be quite beautiful in this way, you see men at their very best in some ways. What's the weight you think that a real boxing fan likes to watch?
Well, I think in this country, they've been brought up on heavyweights, but the other weight which gets a lot of notice is the middleweights. I mean, we're good in this country. We've got great middleweights and super middleweights at the moment. So, you know, you've got, you know, boys that are good fighters. They if you look at a middleweight, which is the average weight of a man, I suppose, 11 stone 6, there's more of that weight of men, and, you know, they can punch hard, they're good boxers, and people like, look, so...
It's the best of both worlds, because sometimes when you see bantamweights or flyweights, it's like a little couple of little boys scrapping, isn't it?
Yeah, well, I mean, yeah, but I mean, they're good. I mean, if you're a boxing man, you like good boxing, well, you like to watch those little guys because
technique.
You know, they got good techniques, they box well, but, you know, I still think the British public like to see dramatic, and in the middleweight and the heavyweight, that is where you get where punching...
They like to see two heavyweights, ideally,
you know,
a bit drunk, slugging it out in a bar. That's with bottles sometimes. That's and a chair and maybe a knife.
That boxing,
that's a good, exciting fight for me. See, I always wanted to see you pull a knife out in a fight. That would have really, that would, for me, would have been a great fight. That would have shown that Ali was boss. Come out with a kosh next time, Henry.
Yeah.
Man, you know, I am such an admirer of you because you've always, I think, maintained, not only have you had a long career, a successful career, but you've always maintained a great dignity, I think.
I mean, please God, I mean, that's what you say. I mean, I always say there used to be in boxing, I think it's been tarnished a little bit now, there was a certain dignity about boxing and boxers. I think that now, with the current trend, how things are going, like scrapping outside the rings and all the slagging each other off, they've lost that bit of dignity now, which I think is a shame. But anyway.
Well, that's what's funny. In the book Henry Cooper, it's the authorised biography of Henry. It's out this Christmas, as I said. In the book, there's photographs of you with boxers who you're just about to go in with, and you can see a genuine sportsmanship there. You're shaking hands, calling each other names, you're not accusing each other of any unusual sexual practices.
Nah.
You're not, you know, saying that you have slept with each other's mothers or sisters or brothers or pets.
We want to eat the children like Tyson has said.
Although when Tyson says it, you know, it's not really a threat, it's a promise with Tyson, isn't it? You know, he's hungry, he's snacking, he feels it's okay. You know what he's like. He's a strange fellow, isn't he?
Oh, dear.
God bless him. Henry, I hope the book's a huge success for you. It's lovely to see you. And I hope you have a great Christmas.
Jonathan, thank you very much, and same to you, mate.
And please, there's an eager public out there. They want another album from you. Get back in that recording studio with Simon Cowell.
He won the bad old singer, Grandad.
Henry, it's lovely to see you. Thank you very much indeed for coming in. OK, let's end on a bit of Zager and Evans, shall we?
Yeah, we've got a bit of time.
It's in the year 2525.
Yeah.